see, I move we approve minutes from February 9th, 2016.
With that one comment I made?
I didn't get, whatever you mentioned, I did not get.
I'll resend it, okay.
So you...
You want to say what it was?
Well, I made a comment, well, I stated, when we're talking about Skims, that Skims should put together information on what alternatives they've looked at and present that to the public, so everybody knows.
Well, you did say that, yeah, okay.
I would like that reflected in the minutes.
Okay. That's unanimous.
Okay.
So I guess we'll approve the minutes then with that addition, that amendment. And we have number two, scheduled appointments. John Hanna, Fire Department, fees, discussion and vote.
So I'm going to pass out a few things here. This first packet is a comparison of Fire Department fees that you've seen before.
Yep.
John's here tonight to talk about it, and he also gave us South Deerfield's and Sunderland's. So I'll pass those around.
I think this is for John.
Is there a reason some are circled on here?
Yeah, that's mine. Sorry, I had to copy my notes. That was from my review.
Oh, okay.
Here's three sets. I was circling ones that I thought needed some particular attention. They're more on the commercial end of things. So I'm not sure how you want to do this, whether you have any questions for John or whether you want to go through them individually.
There's a lot
on here.
Well, how do these two compare to what John had? Are they different or?
You mean what I have?
What you were recommending.
Oh, I thought they were on that list, weren't they?
Well, yeah, they're on the one you put together, but we got South Deerfield and Sunderland.
I think what he's asking is since you've...
The two new ones.
Since you've collected the new two, have any of your recommendations changed?
No, they haven't changed. I don't think that either one of these two are what as high as Hatfield's, I don't think.
So Hatfield's higher.
Yeah.
Okay.
And they have more.
So basically, John, we're, sort of keeping up with Hatfield, but not always necessarily, which is fine with me. I mean, if you think these are reasonable.
I think that some of the rates are reasonable. I don't know. Like I told Mark this afternoon, or morning, whatever it was, you can set those at any rate that you want. I mean, you can mark them up, you can mark them down. It doesn't matter to me. Like I told my wife, I told her, you know, for example, if there's an inspection that needs to be done by the fire department, there should be a fee for it. Presently, the fire department doesn't charge for it. Like liquor licenses, if Mary Ellen gets me, you go out and do them every year, you know, there's no fee from the fire department to do them, which I think there should be. Somebody gets paid, somebody has a fee and they actually charge for them, but I think that comes from the building inspector's office now. But
so now you don't charge at all, you don't
get it. The fire department gets nothing. And every year there's more and more.
Where does the fee money go?
General fund.
But some of these you had on here, well, like for, let me ask for a storage tank on here, LP gas storage.
Mm-hmm.
Permit fee, you had $25. How do they get that? They go to Mary Ellen and apply, or does that go to you and you issue?
They actually download that form offline and they send it to the fire department. And I approve it or deny it. And
offline from where? What side?
From the state. The plumbing people would have to make that determination, or the gas person actually fills out that application. I can't think of the number off the top of my head. It's covered CMR 527, and they make out that application to install a propane tank in the town of Whately. They make it out and they send it, and send it with a check to the Whately Fire Department. And when I get that, then they'll tell me that it's in, and I go and inspect it. Make sure it's in, like, especially if it's an underground tank, or it has to be X number of feet from a window, the gas companies changed up their mind, and they had a big push because gas is cheaper than oil and cheaper than electricity. So there's a lot of installations for that in town.
But who checks the actual location of that? Do you?
Me. Me. For the $25 fee.
Okay. And does a building inspector check on that as well?
No.
Because I get, that's one difference though. Whately doesn't have our own building inspector. We rely on Franklin County.
Right.
Whereas I think Hatfield has their own, I think, and don't, and so what? I don't know.
Hatfield has their own inspector.
Own inspector, and Sunderland and Deerfield have their own?
Deerfield has their own. I don't know about Sunderland, whether they do or they don't.
Okay. I looked at all the fees that you're proposing and increases, and I guess I could see what you're asking for, anywhere from $300 to $500 more for somebody that's building new house or major remodeling.
Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter to me what you do with it, but I mean, what's your recommendation? What I'm saying is, every time they sell a house in the town of Whately, they have to have my signature in order to sell that house, because I have to go and inspect the smoke detectors and carbon monoxide detectors in that house. I get $25, and every real estate agent comes and tells me, how come you're so cheap? How come your price is so low? And that's what I hear every time I go out. I mean, I only do, I don't know, 20 or so a year, but still. Yeah, it's just.
What is that called on here? What is it? Fire alarm?
No, smoke detector. Is it under smoke detector inspection?
Smoke detector is carbon monoxide.
Mm-hmm.
For residents and business ones. Okay, but it's 25 for first unit, 102 units. What is the? The unit, is that a housing unit, or is that the smoke detector unit?
Both South Deerfield and Sunderland and Hatfield all have multi-family dwellings.
Oh.
That, you know, apartment complexes. We don't have any, but if it's there, it's just a piece. It's just black and white. It says that if they actually decided they were going to put, if they were going to change like Rainbow Motel over to a multi-family dwelling, you know, if each one of those is an apartment instead of a motel, each one of those would get inspected as a separate dwelling. You know, if they made like two family out of one, you know, two apartment, a bedroom and a living room out of one, and they had more than three apartments, because they fall under a different code.
We do have multiple units.
Yeah, just three.
Apartments.
Just three, right? The most we have is three.
Three.
I think.
What, three units? I don't know if there's any fours or not, but I don't remember, but. You could be right, yeah.
If there's any fours, they've all been grandfathered. There's no fire protection systems in them.
Right.
There's no detection. There's no alarm systems in them. There's no protection systems in them. If you're thinking of the two houses in the center of town.
Yeah.
There's no one, two, three. I think the one on the south side of the inn is only three. I'm not sure that the one on the north side may be four, but I think there's only three.
Which ones of these are most critical to you? That, I mean, either you don't, if it's zero on here, does that mean you don't do the inspection? You don't get involved? Is that what zero means?
There's no charge.
There's no charge, but you still do fire alarm work permit,
mm-hmm,
fire
yep.
protection.
They don't do fire alarm work permit. I got two texts within the last week. They worked on the school for one, and just a couple days ago, I could look on my phone and tell you when they were. And they worked on Yankee Candle just the other day, and there was no permits taken out for them. I just get notified that they're actually working on them.
Okay. So under your proposal, they would have to take out permits?
Well, they should, yes. They have to, take out a permit for them to do electrical work or change my, fix my furnace in my house. Or modify it.
How do you ensure that? How do you know they take out permits to?
I would guess that we'd have to send a letter to the companies that have protection systems that they would have to, you know, not to the residents, you know, it's like you have to have a permit. For the school, for example, you'd have to send Pete a letter and say, from them to come and work on your protection system, you need a permit to do that. And I just used to say to school that there's only 6 or 8 buildings. This one, for example. But you don't, like I said, you don't have to do that. That's just my recommendation that you do that. And then they would have to go back, and I assure that because they worked at the school a couple weeks ago, well, lo and behold, they never put the system back in service. They did there, but they didn't take, they take it out of service and show up with control, but they never told them it's back in service. I have to chase them down, and I had to call the company and say, why did you do this? You know, it's just one of those things. If they take a permit out, that's what they're supposed to do. They're supposed to notify the company that the system's out. They're supposed to notify the department that the system's out, and vice versa.
But if there's a building permit required, are you, you're on the sign-off for the building permit before they issue the final?
I am now. For the, for a regular building permit?
For a building permit, yes.
I am now, but that doesn't always go well, but.
And that's assuming there's a final inspection by the building inspector, right?
Are we referring to 23 for State Road? That building permit?
No, I'm referring to
anyone?
In general.
Yes, I am notified, and as they, the building inspector is supposed to, as I understand, is supposed to go by my recommendation for fire protection system in a house. Okay. So I have to review the plans and inspect the building when it, before the certificate of occupancy that got out is issued.
Okay. And if the building inspector does not do a final inspection, then
they have 3 days to do it, or it passes. That's the way it works. All the inspections, they say, they have 3 days. Once she notify them, they're ready for inspection. They have 3 days to get there to do it, or it passes.
But then that leaves you out of the loop, right? If they don't come within 3 days, it passes. You don't get a chance to.
Well, they also need my autograph on them too. There's a place on my, on the building permit for my signature for to test the smoke alarms.
Right.
And they don't get a certificate of occupancy without my autograph. Right. But they always, they just call me and I go down and do it.
Does it make sense for John and I to put together a sheet like this, a simple chart, and bring it back to you so you can see it in a more clear? This is a little hard to follow.
Yeah, it is.
And there's some items that probably don't pertain to Whately here either, so, yeah.
Right. And it looks like John has left some of these things off, at least. Does that sound okay? I mean, I'm just making a suggestion so that you guys can see it in a little more clear version, I guess. Trying to go back and forth between three versions.
Right. Well, let me ask you, two things come to mind. I don't know if it's appropriate to have inspection in here by you or not. One is on solar systems. When they connect
bad
solar.
Subject, Fred.
Pardon?
It's a bad subject to me.
When they inspect either individual houses or commercial, these commercial ones, or solar farms, I guess you want to call it. As far as the fire inspection, I guess, is that something that should be in here?
Absolutely, I think so. Is I anybody, really do, but the code doesn't require it.
Is anybody else doing that?
I don't think so. That's all an electrical issue, but the fire department should be notified. But the problem with that is that's a multifold problem. Okay, obviously when there's two fields, the two companies that we have in Whately to put fields in have been very good, and they have taken the fire department on an evening and showed us how to run the system. Of course, the one we have in back of the fire station, we haven't been here since We haven't been, either one of them hadn't had a problem since they were installed. The problem with those systems is you can't de-energize them without unplugging the arrays. That is the problem. So if somebody goes in there to mow the lawn, or heaven forbid Alan Sanderson goes out there with his tractor, something goes awry medically and drives into the field, I have no way of knowing whether the electricity is off on, so I can get him out of there. I can't tell whether that's off, and guess what? I can't get him out. My people aren't going there.
So what happens then?
You know, I don't know. I don't know the answer to that, and I can't get the answer to that.
Who gets them out? Do you have to call the solar company themselves?
The one across the street up here is out of Boston.
Okay.
There's no cutoff switch?
Not between the array
between the service
and the street.
System.
Yeah, shut it off from the street.
Yeah,
but
it's still producing electricity.
Exactly. And you know what? It doesn't. It's the same thing on a house.
Yeah, what do you do in a house? I mean, how do you shut it off in the house then?
You can. You can shut it off from the street, but from the array, which is somewhere on the property, typically on the roof, is always energized. You can't shut it off, other than they say cover them. Well, you can't. How many canvases do I have to carry? And they don't recommend you covering them with canvases because it doesn't work. You don't know, you can't guarantee that you're going to cut off all the light on them. I know what's going to happen. My people aren't going to go anywhere near them.
So what would you do if you were required to inspect them? What would people have to do differently?
The only thing they would have to do differently is we would know that they're there and respond accordingly on the scene.
Well, I assume you can tell by looking at a roof, though, can't you?
We would figure out where the shutoffs are, so you have to shut it off from the street. And yeah, but if they're covered with snow, you may not know that they're there.
Right.
If they're covered with snow, they're probably not going to be making electricity, but you know, those are all things that you don't. It's a new hazard. It's a new field. I can't even get it. I asked about 2 years ago to get a class. They just now write a class on how to deal with them.
So should you have a listing of all the properties?
Absolutely. I'd love to have a listing of them. The guy sitting next to you probably has the best listing that I know of. I mean, they put them on garages, they put them on sheds, they put them on. Nick Jones has got them all over his property down there.
But when and it's a question for Paul, when people put them on their houses, do they have to get a permit or a register?
Yeah, they have to get a permit, and it has to be installed by a licensed electrician.
Right.
Who is the permit from?
Building inspector.
Okay, from the
electrical inspector.
Electrical, okay.
But I don't have that list. I would have to go back, and I get notified of all the permits that are issued in Whately, but yeah. I'd have to go back years, but I don't have a running list of actual solar panels that are installed in Whately.
I don't have a list either. I have a list of who qualified for Solarize, but there were a lot of systems up before that program,
mm-hmm.
which I don't know who has them. How many incidents have there been in your that you know of regarding people getting shocked from?
Just this winter, I saw two. I think there was it Boston or just somewhere in the state. There was two firefighters that were injured from solar panels. And what would happen is they go to vent a roof and they cut through the cable, the trunk line from the panel, it goes to the shut off line.
Yeah.
And it electrifies the saw. That's the big issue.
So there have been two is too many.
Yeah. Okay.
And the other thing, wood stoves, you know, we had a fatality, a year or two ago, would have involved a wood stove mm-hmm. in the house.
I don't inspect wood stoves, Fred.
Inspect? Is there a reason that you should, or?
Well, yeah, that's a very good reason that I should. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, they should be inspected every year because they deteriorate, and that's exactly what happened down on State Road.
Right.
I don't inspect them, and the reason I don't inspect them is because I can't see inside the chimney.
Right.
The building is
at least the location in the house where they're at.
Mm-hmm.
They're hooked up or whatever, but yeah.
Right.
No.
Mm-hmm.
They are inspected by the building inspector.
On installation.
Installation.
On installation?
That's it.
Okay. Yeah, okay.
But the deal on State Road was it deteriorated over the years, caused the house to start fire. And, you know, and the deal with wood stoves is there's so many different kinds out there that, and they're all installed, they're supposed to be installed by factory recommendations. You know, the hearths have to be so big, the mantles have to be so far away, and if that's the case on them. And not have stuff stacked all around them. And
so is there any precedent for instituting a wood stove inspection after the initial inspection? Anywhere that you know of?
No, there's no, once it's installed properly, that's all there is, to the best of my knowledge.
I mean, could we institute an inspection?
Sure. I think we should have to be invited into the home. I mean, if we put something out there that the fire department would come inspect your wood stove, the installation, and we'd be happy to do that.
At no charge to them.
You're going to pay. Somebody's going to pay, I'll bet, because okay. I'd have to hire somebody to do it.
We should add that to our fee schedule.
Our wood stoves?
Yeah, wood stove inspection.
Mm-hmm. Just, you know, there is some notation of it on the assessor's report card. We go in and look at property, we know whether it's a wood stove, fireplace.
Chris Brothers might be able to give me a list of what is actually out there. Yeah. You think? Well, along with the solar panels, just the solar panels.
I don't think we need a yearly inspection, though. You'd spend the whole all day inspecting wood stoves. Well,
yeah, you'd have to make an appointment to get in the house because you can't look at it.
Right.
It's not like looking at an installation of a propane tank that's outside.
You know what I mean?
You'd have to, you know, try to
do a lot of after hours, kind of.
Or weekends.
Weekends.
Mm-hmm.
So are you recommending or suggesting maybe that
we look into, maybe
insulation or
after insulation? No, during insulation, it's inspected.
Right.
So we don't need another inspection, but maybe a 5-year, a 4-year inspection, which would be better than what we got.
Oh yeah, I mean, probably it should be more than like every other year because, you know, what happens when they go in and they carpet a room? You know, those are the kind of things that, I think we had a house fire in West Whately. I think Schmaltz's house, that's what that happened.
Oh, really?
Yep. Log rolled out of the fireplace onto the carpet. But, you know, that's
so you're saying fireplaces as well as wood stoves?
It's open fire. It's a fire. It's you know. Well, the fireplaces won't get changed, but really.
Well, other than the surroundings, yeah, kind of.
The thing with a wood stove is you can bring it up, carry one in, go to Home Depot and buy one, you know, and bring it in.
Right.
And put it in, you know, illegally. And
of course, if people put it in illegally, they're not going to call you up to have it inspected.
Exactly.
Right.
But then what happens is we had a chimney fire down here next to the school last winter, that it's like they have pipes that run all through the house, and it's like, it's probably a legal installation, but it's not cleaned, you know, and that's what you really find.
Well, since you're doing solar, why don't you look at?
Excuse me.
Think about what you're doing solar? Or?
No, I think the solar issue is a different issue. Issue is an issue of how to de-energize a system, which, you know, looking at a solar system, you're not going to be able to do much about it, except know it's there.
Mm-hmm.
And wait for the state to have some sort of protocol for dealing with solar systems in a way
My protocol is my people are not going anywhere near the panels.
Right.
But you won't vent, you won't cut holes in that side of the roof, because typically they fill the whole side of the roof. You would actually have to vent the other side. I mean, the fire is underneath those panels. I'm sorry, you know.
Sure. Well,
you know, that was your choice.
That's right. And people should know that.
Oh, absolutely.
And they can get homeowners insurance for that. I mean, you buy a car, that's your choice, and mm-hmm. you insure it.
Yep.
And it's dangerous. You know, cars kill a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think solar panels kill that many yet, but we don't want him to kill anybody.
Right.
All right, so we'll take that under advisement.
So we'll put together maybe a condensed list and bring it back to you.
Of solar installations?
Or just all these fees together.
All the fees together, okay, yeah. And John wants, I think we should try to get a list of people with solar so that
the
fire department shows up and then they are snow covered or something, they should know that there's solar collectors up there. Not that they'd be energized if they were covered with snow, but nonetheless, the snow might fall off while the fire's going on. They get energized and then you get a problem.
I've been told that in the literature that we go there and put floodlights up in the front driveway, that's enough to energize those panels.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
Well.
And not as much as if the direct sun is on them, but it's enough to smart.
Okay.
Look at some,
something to consider.
The other thing, look at some of these to me are, I don't know what size tanks you're looking at.
Find that.
For some, or look at the some of your shock items on here. What size? I mean, any size storage, above ground storage tank, or does it have to be over, I don't know, 200 gallons or 55 gallons? No, any. Well, you say storage tank. I don't know. You have above ground storage, and then there's propane listed separately. What's above ground? Gasoline tank? You allow that? Diesel fuel?
It's the first one.
The first one, above ground storage tank.
Do I see it?
I don't remember what it was.
What is that for? And I guess what?
I don't remember what it was. I'd be honest with you.
What's that?
It could be oil. Could be fuel oil. It could be propane, but if there's another propane issue in there, it could be the 70,000 gallon tanks across the street over here. It could be the 30,000 gallon diesel fuel tanks that are over here. But those would be above ground. To me, those would be above ground storage tanks.
So, John, how do you think the getting back to the wood stove inspection thing, I'm wondering what the best way to go about, I mean, what we want to do is make sure that nobody has a potentially dangerous wood stove installation.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we could say the fire department will inspect your wood stove installation.
And make recommendations.
And what?
And make recommendations.
And make recommendations. But at your request, at the homeowner's request.
Right, they would have to call and ask for somebody to come and inspect it. So.
And there'll be a charge of $25, mm-hmm. whatever.
And what we would try to do is, I'm sure what you would take that day, and it's like you get six or eight of them scheduled the same day, 20 to 30 minutes apart, and then you would just send one or two guys out to do it. When was the last time you had it cleaned? Oh, maybe 3 years ago. Well, you should really definitely, it should be cleaned every year.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, those are things that people just don't do.
Well, here's another thing. Now, I haven't checked this out, but I think this is all very good information, both in the solar part as well as the wood stove part. And perhaps with our new website, we can make available information on what makes for a safe wood stove installation. So if you have any questions about whether your installation is safe, please call Chief Hannum. Or if you have a solar system, the fire department would like to know that, so also let us know, we'll let you know, or we'll let the chief know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we can't go around, I mean, you can go around and know who has, just by observation, solar collectors, and you do the same with wood stove. You go around and see blue smoke coming out of people's chimney and assume there's a wood stove in there, or mm-hmm. look for wood sheds, but you know, once we have that information, let's say you did Google Earth and you found out who had wood storage. Mm-hmm. Assume they have wood stove. And then what do? With that information, you go up and say, we know you have a wood stove and we think you should have us inspect it.
Well, I would think I would use town report. Yeah, you could use town report that goes out. You could use the scoop, town meeting. They're all coming up, you know. And if this is something we want to do, then we should, you know, make the announcement at town meeting. And
okay, let's do it in the scoop. The deadline's tomorrow. Today's
how's that work?
Tomorrow morning, 9 o'clock.
Tomorrow morning, 9 o'clock. Yeah. So let's get an announcement over to Joyce about wood stove inspections.
Did you do an article for this?
Did I?
For this?
Can I?
No, did you already? No. Okay, I was going to suggest maybe we can just modify it before the deadline.
I think it's the 24th, which is
tomorrow.
Oh, it's tomorrow. Today's the 23rd.
Today's 24th.
Yeah, so I think
but to know whether people have or not, if they're not willing to share that.
Well, we can't do anything.
No, but I mean the assessors have, we have records on some of that. So you could always go through there. She could sort by that code.
Chris Brothers should probably pull it up too.
Give you everything. Yeah.
So what we ought to do, I think, is have a database of who in town has, you know, solar systems and who has wood stoves, mm-hmm. and fill it up as we can go along without, we can't get snooping and invade people's privacy, but that information should be known to at least the fire department. Mm-hmm. We don't have to have it on the website necessarily. I don't think people need to have
it. But you could do the same, you could put a listing of the, attach it to the fire department on the, off the website, you know, if you wanted to do it, something like that, and just safe recommendations for wood stove.
So we'll be reaching out to all the departments to gather information for the new website,
mm-hmm.
probably in the next, I'd say next couple of months too.
Okay.
One thing we could do with wood stoves in the web, maybe in the internet side is have a wood stove safety quiz, and the homeowner checks, you know, and takes a little quiz, and if they get it all right, that's good. If they don't, maybe, you know, if you get a score of under 8 out of 10 or something, you should call the fire department. You should call the fire department anyway. Get it looked at, but you know, if you want to make sure you know how to fix it up right,
mm-hmm.
get their input. That's reasonable.
You would think other communities, like maybe in the hill towns, would have inspections like that, wouldn't you?
Not that I know of.
You're not aware of anybody who does that.
Okay. After the initial installation.
Yeah, after initial.
And what's the most common cause of household fires?
Cooking.
How about wood stoves? Do they
careless disposal? It used to be careless disposal of smoking materials, but now, in the last few years, it's more cooking than it is.
And by wood stoves, you define that as pellets and what?
Logs.
Does that include pellets, wood, and coal, and charcoal, and whatever else you put in there?
I don't know if we have any coal.
No, but what wood is a generic term. It's just a, pellets,
yeah, we can do pellet stoves too.
But that would apply to all kinds of stoves that provide heat, mm-hmm. I guess, mm-hmm. or cooking, whatever you call it.
All right, well, we got some work to do here, it looks like.
I told you it was a good day.
Yeah.
Well, I appreciate you sharing these concerns, John.
Okay. Very good.
We want to make sure people are as safe as they can be.
Thank you.
Use your services as little as possible. And have.
They're doing good at that.
Yeah.
And tomorrow night they're showing a fire truck demonstrator at the fire station.
Oh, good.
KMH, so.
Tomorrow what time?
5:30. Truck's supposed to be there.
5:30.
Because we might buy a demo. I don't know. We'll see. See what the committee wants to do.
Alrighty,
thank you.
Okay, thanks. So I just passed out the project list. It's just an updated list. You can see that I crossed out a few things that have been completed and moved them down below. And then I wrote some updates in bold.
Good.
Next to some of them. Let me back up. We agreed to check in on this every few weeks, so mm-hmm. I don't think we've looked at it in a month now, so I brought it back just to give you some updates, and I'll keep doing this frequently to let you know where things are at.
Okay.
So you can take that home with you and just read it another time if you want to.
Is Keith going to be in today, tonight? We don't have any highway.
Keith, he's not supposed to be here tonight.
No. He's not supposed to be?
No.
Okay. And Jim?
Would you like both of them to come in?
Well, I don't know. Seems like Keith is here kind of regularly. I didn't know he had particular calls to attend.
I have some things that Keith gave me today that he needs signed from you guys, but I didn't They're just signature, so I didn't think he needed.
Okay, that's fine.
I'll invite them both in at the next meeting.
I mean, I don't have specific questions for him, except when are the bridges on Waynesburg Road going to be dealt with? But that's a perennial question.
Right.
One kind of critical item here on your list, it's an immediate priority, and I just heard about funding for this, for the magnesium treatment, to seek funding. Is that, I thought there was a grant, special grant made to the town for that.
It's not a grant. It's actually, Rosenberg's office, I believe, announced it as a grant. It's a low-interest loan.
Oh, it's a loan, okay.
Right, so you're correct. That was approved by the state, and once, right now they're in the process of testing. Actually, they're going to be seeking funding at this next special town meeting to run some tests on different filtration systems. And at that point, once they decide on what the best course of action is to remove the manganese, they'll be probably filing for a loan to get some funding for that. But it's not a grant.
Okay, because I don't know if people have been questioning you about what the article was in the paper, but people have been asking me, what's the $400,000 the water department got for this?
Yeah, and unfortunately,
it wasn't stated correctly.
There wasn't a lot of communication on that. It was announced by Rosenberg's office, unfortunately, before we were notified even. And Hadley was in the same boat. They received funding also. But again, it's low interest loan, and they'll be, once they get a course of action in place, we'll be back to talk about that.
Okay,
special town meeting warrant review, vote and signature.
I'm gonna pass out some copies of the warrant. And I guess what I'd say is, if we could just go through these, we can go through them at any pace you want to, but at the end, right now, every single article says recommended. If you decide not to recommend any of these articles, I'll go back and change them, but I'd like to get you guys to sign a copy tonight so that we can post it on time. You want me to just go through these articles one at a time?
Sure.
So Article 1, just a brief summary here. This is for $9,940. This is to fund the HVAC software. This was paid to us by the MLS at closing. So it's not actually an expense that is on our dime, but unfortunately at closing that money rolled to free cash, or will roll to free cash. So we have to request that it come out of free cash now. I tried to have it put in escrow, but it wasn't a possibility, so.
Now there is money, or you do have an account to pay for some items to finalize the building here, right? Why isn't that?
What do you mean? We have a town building operations account,
right?
Yeah, but we didn't budget for $10,000 in software. I mean, the budget was done a year before we.
Is there money available for it in that account for this?
That can fund it?
Yes.
We could fund it. I mean, we're 2 weeks away from the town meeting now, and if it's a free cash article, the money is available that day anyway. Yeah. We could fund it. I mean, there's $20,000-$30,000 in that account, but if we fund it and don't get this money, then we don't have enough money to continue to operate the building. So.
So that money is going to be needed through June?
And the money that's in that account, yes. The only thing we budgeted for last year, because we didn't know whether we were buying this building or not, was the buildings we owned.
Right.
And then at the last special town meeting, I asked for funding from October 6th, which is when we purchased the building, through the end of the fiscal year.
Okay.
So we haven't budgeted specifically for this. Those are just regular operational costs that we've budgeted for. So this is over and above.
And what happens if we don't spend all that money by June 30th?
Is it just like any account, it rolls to free cash.
Rolls to free cash, yep. Okay.
The next Article 2, is $8,000 for the purchase of chairs and meeting tables for multiple meeting rooms. Mm-hmm. It would be this room here, the meeting room down here, just chairs, to replace the chairs in this meeting room and tables and chairs in this meeting room. It's a total of about 68 chairs and probably just one or two tables, because we own a few tables now.
So, only 68 chairs for, even for the large meeting room?
No, not the large meeting.
Not the large?
No, it's for the meeting rooms in this wing right now.
Oh, okay.
It's not for the long range plan.
To replace these chairs.
Right, to replace all the red chairs that are spread out throughout the building. As soon as the MLS leaves, all these tables and chairs go, so we need something to replace them.
Okay.
Article 3 is for roof repairs, which we've talked about recently because I had you guys sign the contract. Just a reminder, it's to install snow guards above the vents so that we don't continue to get those ice jams and, you know, bending the vent stacks up there. It's to repair the vent stacks that are already damaged. It's to replace the damaged trim out front and seal the roof up. Article 4 is, this is an article that is specifically for the school, and I'll just read our accountant's explanation on this. It's a little tricky because this money was in the circuit breaker account, and my understanding is that when we were going through closing out fiscal 15, the Department of Revenue required him to move that funding to free cash. So it's in the free cash account now, and the school is asking that we vote to pull that money back out. It's $26,939. So what Ray said, our accountant, is my understanding is that the account can hold no more than a year's amount of the grant. So the DOR required that we reduce the amount in the fund at year end to 1 year's worth, the excess being transferred to free cash. The issue arose because of an auditor's adjustment to the account. So there's some reason that the school needs this money back, and they're gonna plan to make the motion and explain that at a town meeting.
Why was it not recommended by finance?
I think they didn't recommend it because they didn't fully support it, and there wasn't enough information at the time available to them. You know, I explained to them the same thing I did to you, that the school would be there to explain it, and, you know, maybe they'll change their minds at that time, but they didn't feel comfortable recommending it at that point, so.
I'm okay with the rest of these on this page if we want to move along.
Okay.
You have any? You have any?
Okay, well, you're reading, let me go for 6 years.
As we go along with these.
Yeah, there's 15 articles totally. 16
hours. Yeah. Where's Key stand on the electrical? Is he still getting permits then? Or, I mean, estimates?
Yeah, I believe he's trying to collect 3 estimates. And I know he had at least one originally, so I'm assuming he's getting some others now.
Okay, go to 9.
Okay with that. Okay with 10. 11.
11 is a planning board request. My understanding is that they required an easement to the water line back in 2009, I think it was, when John was applying for the planning board permit, and they're requesting it be released now.
Fine.
And Don will be there to explain that article. The rest are all water enterprise department. Fund water department. Articles.
Oh, okay.
And the water commissioners and superintendent will be there to make those motions and explain if anyone has. Most of them I can answer, but if there's questions I can't answer.
Okay.
Do you have any articles on here that you do not want to support?
I don't.
Just a question, what is 9/10 vote required on some of these?
Yeah, Articles 9 and 10 require 9/10 votes because they are prior fiscal year.
That counts.
Article 10, it's only $23.09, and that's unfortunately petty cash receipts that were left from our former treasurer collector at the end of the fiscal year.
No, I have no questions about this.
So I'm going to pass.
If we're done with this, Mr. Chair, could I ask that we go to item D, the Waste Committee of
sure.
Appointments, so Mr. Dawson can get on his way here.
Can I just have you sign a couple of originals so that
okay.
I can. Just so that I can give it to Lynn for posting. I mean, we can do it at the same time if you want. But.
Okay.
So, I think you all received the email from Clint, right, requesting that he be appointed to the Solid Waste Committee. I did suggest when we originally spoke that he contact the State Ethics Commission and get a ruling from them. He did that. I'll let you speak. I just wanted to give them a little background here. I know that there was some hesitation on Fran's part, not because of you, just you know his concerns related to staffing issues and whatnot. But I can pass out Fran's comments here if that's helpful. Maybe you already saw them, I'm not sure. But anyway, that's all I have. If you guys want to.
Let me take a look at it again.
Yep. So this is Fran's email with his concern, and this is Quint's request to be appointed and his determination from the State Ethics Commission.
And how many members are on the Solid Waste Committee?
Three.
Right now, there's three, so you would be the fourth one.
No, I filled one of the, there were two vacancies. Well, one is not a vacancy yet. Bill is leaving March 1st, and we just lost the other member. His name escapes me at the moment.
Gary Moore.
Gary.
Right. Okay,
so, you'd be the third one.
I'd make it the third one. Right.
And what is the total for the committee?
Three.
Oh, that's all there's ever been is
right.
Three.
And they've already appointed this other gentleman that I haven't met, don't know.
Yeah, you guys appointed someone last.
Larry Kutner.
That's not Larry Kutner and Fran, and it would be you, the right. Three of you.
Right.
So Fran's concerns were the conflict of interest, and there's a response. You have a response.
This was his determination from the State Ethics Commission.
Okay,
You spoke with them also, right?
So
you spoke with an attorney on the
And since I am not an attorney, I think it was a final step. You might want to actually speak to them yourself if you're. I mean, I was satisfied that, from my understanding, the main thing is that I needed to file a disclosure,
right.
And then just be careful about what I voted on without getting additional permission from the selecting.
So Fran's recommending double check with the AG or town's lawyer on the potential conflict of interest issue. So that, was that done?
That's what this is.
And this says, this is just a disclosure. So we don't have an opinion from our lawyer on this, right?
I did not seek an opinion from our lawyer, no.
But there's an opinion in there from
that's my report of my conversation. I think technically that conversation is not an official finding from them, if I understand correctly. I mean, it was a discussion, you know, and a sort of a helping me through the issues, and it sounded like it was going to be fine to me, but somewhere I think I saw that it doesn't necessarily constitute a permanent finding, you know, an official finding, so.
I haven't talked with Fran further about this, about his issues. I mean, they seem reasonable to me. On the other hand,
it seems like you provided a great service for the town throughout, and you know a lot about the situation. It's hard to get people on committees. I think we would be fortunate to have somebody with your background and knowledge on the committee. And I think with Larry and Fran also on the committee, I don't, you know, I just don't know that it's, you know, that, I don't know that it's compelling enough to say, you can be on the committee, but as a non-voting member, I'm not sure.
Who comes in non-voting for, on what? Topics, so if it's on setting the pay of the workers.
Yeah, that's done by personnel.
Okay.
That's done by personnel. So this might be conflicts over any change in operating hours or open hours, performance evaluations, budgets, and personalities. Well, who does the budget and personnel evaluation? The chair of the
budget. The budget is the operating budget, salaries aside, are generally done by the committee as a whole. I just get a, I send them a budget request, they send it back. You know, again,
they don't, and they don't determine the salaries, so
no,
I don't see a problem there.
No.
I also, you know, performance evaluations, I mean, there's three people on this committee doing, you know, performance evaluations, or with the chair.
You know, I'm not sure who, I'm assuming that the, do you know, I mean, last year.
I've had one evaluation and it was done by the committee.
Last year?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. I didn't know. I did receive them back, but I don't know who conducted them. I can't remember now. So, it sounds like you'd have to.
I visualize myself taking off that hat and putting on my employment hat and coming hat in hand to be reviewed by the other two members. Me as an employee, and there's
employees to evaluate themselves, or is that just chairs?
No, employees evaluate themselves also.
Okay, so you would evaluate yourself. Obviously, you would recuse yourself from evaluating yourself as your own employer.
Right.
Although, the committee's not really the employer. The town is the employer. Abilities to fire and hire and fire staff are up to us, right?
Right, that stays with you. But they're the Solid Waste Committee basically is the supervisor of the staff. That's why they are conducting the performance evaluations. But hiring and firing would remain with you.
And how many staff are there?
Basically four. Two main,
you and
Lee.
Lee.
And then two backups, Roger Gord and Lee's wife, Rebecca.
Rebecca.
But we also have a volunteer, Regina.
What do you think, Fred?
About
having
this thing here says something we have seen in the past.
And, yeah, I don't know what that's about.
Yeah, and I guess I would recommend we appoint him subject to if he has any more information to provide on what he means by that statement.
I wish he'd come to the meeting.
Or I guess ask what specifically is he talking about, and we can defer until the next meeting.
I have not seen that, so I'm not sure.
There's no timeliness issue.
Fred makes mention of there being issues in the past, but he doesn't say what those issues are.
Not with you, I think.
Not with you, as far as I know. And I think he would have said something that had it been, and that would have come up in your evaluation, I would think. And I haven't seen your evaluation, so I don't know. But
yeah, what's the context to that? There's some. Besides potential conflicts over changing open hours, performance evaluations, budgets, and personalities in committee. A committee with a worker manager supervising other workers sets up a likely perception, unfair or not, that the worker manager's opinion will get preferential treatment and perhaps breed resentment, something we have seen in the past.
Resentment among other workers. I assume.
Yeah, I don't know what that specifically refers to. I don't know if you have any history on that. But
not that I can
that I can think of, I can see the point too.
I guess I would ask him to further clarify that, and if he can't or doesn't want to, then I guess I do not see a reason why we can't act on it.
Yeah.
Next meeting. Ask him for, or two meetings, whatever time you want to give him, but.
I think we can get further clarification by the next meeting. That's 2 weeks from now, so.
If he doesn't want to clarify or doesn't want to.
I could certainly go right now with saying, having Quint as a non-voting worker manager on the committee initially, and then get clarification on this, and if we get clarification, then we make you a voting member.
But if it's not a timely issue.
Does it matter?
Why don't we just wait?
Sure.
I had a long conversation with Fran about what the committee does and so forth.
Yeah.
It does not have regular meetings, and things don't come up very much.
Yeah, well.
Maybe they would if.
I feel like I said originally, I feel like we're fortunate to have you involved, and you're certainly knowledgeable, and so I don't want to, you know, I want you to realize that, and I don't want you to feel disgruntled that.
No, I won't, and I'd be happy to follow what the board decides. It's your responsibility, I think, to make sure that that these don't become issues. And if it's something that's going to be an issue ongoing or constantly or something.
Well, I wonder if having you as a non-voting member, how that solves whatever potential conflicts there are.
I'm not quite sure what it means, except that I can be there and participate in discussions, I guess, whatever they are. Make my suggestions, I don't know.
But you can do that now.
I suppose I could, yeah.
You can do that now, that's right. Well, I think.
If they only have meetings.
Right.
I think Quint should be a member of the committee.
Yeah, if we're going to have him as a member, yeah, it should be a full-blown member.
I'll say one more thing. I'd be more comfortable if you decided to appoint me and were satisfied with these other things first, rather than there be any sort of lingering doubt or worry about some of those issues. So I'd be happy if you wanted to take your time, recheck with the commission and see what else Fran has to say, or Bill.
He should be a voting member and have all rights, just like the other two members, I think. I don't see why he should be treated any differently.
Well, maybe we take a little recess on this and table it for the next meeting and get back to you.
It works for me.
I'm sorry that we're not better informed about it, but we do want to act in a judicious way. And if, you know, Fran has been very involved in this for years, so let's get some information from him.
Okay.
And if we don't get any more information, I think we'd make him a member. I don't have a problem with it.
Yeah, I don't have a problem either.
We might want to give Jonathan this. Well, Jonathan has this information, does he?
I don't think so.
Well, yeah, it went to him by the pier, yeah.
Oh, it did?
Yeah, you sent it to
him. Yeah, okay, so he has it too, so.
Oh, okay. Is that from you?
It's from me, probably.
Yeah.
Okay.
Wow.
Yeah. All right, well, I'm sorry, Quint, that there's even any cloudiness about this, but let's disperse the clouds and proceed.
Okay. I will check with Fran, get some more clarification. I'll put it on the next agenda.
Thank you. I am grateful.
Well, we're grateful to your service.
Best job I ever had, as I said.
Well, glad to hear it.
Thank you, guys.
I want you to keep feeling that way, and I'm sorry if this puts a dent in it, but I hope
not a problem.
We'll move forward.
Thanks again.
Okay, thank you. Now, I think it's good to just check it out a little more thoroughly. Sorry we kept him waiting so long. That was my fault.
We should have moved him up.
We should have moved him up right away. Treasurer collector program to update Windows signature required.
Actually, we skipped one.
Solid waste.
Volunteer.
Yes.
Participation.
Oh, yes.
Paul, I know you wanted to talk about this, and I just wanted to say that I did get an email because you guys mentioned it at the last meeting. maybe talking about it again now will encourage more emails like this, but I did get an email from a resident who heard the conversation and is interested in filling a seat. Mary Ellen and I are working right now on putting together, Mary Ellen's working on putting together a list, and I'm going to try to put together some kind of a brochure or something that can be put up on our website, you know, here at the counter and whatnot, but I know you want to talk specifically about recognition, so.
Well, yeah, I just want to say that, you know, running a little town takes a lot of volunteer work, mostly, and of course, you guys do a great job, and I think that it's hard to get people to serve on committees, and maybe one way to encourage more people to take part is to let people who serve on these committees know that they're appreciated and they get some recognition. And that's just not committee members, it's also, you know, town employees. I think there's no reason why we shouldn't have, I think, some sort of poster or listing of everybody who makes Whately work and have it prominently displayed in the town offices here, at least, so as you come in, you would see a listing of who does what for the town. And one way of, you know, recognizing people's service.
Would this be people that are on committees?
It would be people on committees, it would be town employees.
Okay. It's in the annual report right now, it's a fairly lengthy list.
Okay, well, maybe my initial impulse was volunteers on committees.
Okay.
Or people on committees.
Well, all committees are kind of volunteers. Well, or they're appointed either by moderator or select board. Well,
some get stipends, but I mean, I realize they're not.
Yeah, but I don't know, what do you call that?
$100 maybe.
I don't think there's anybody on a committee that's not appointed or by select board or moderator, so it's not like somebody's just going to walk in and, well, we do have one person that shows up here a lot that volunteers, I guess. He's not on our committees, but
officially. Right, and there are a lot of people, you know, that make the town work, and I think people don't realize just how many people there are who make the town work, and so I, you know, it might be an exhaustive list, but it would, you know, help. We could have smaller print, bigger piece of paper. I don't know what the best way to mount something like that would be.
We were talking earlier, what do you think about volunteer of the month or volunteer, you know, spotlight one volunteer?
Well, I think that's a good idea also. I think that in addition, that's a very good idea. I don't know, I'm big into, you know, appreciating people for the work they do, for how little they do it for. And, you know, let's say we put everybody in the town report. How many people is that? 100 people?
They're already in the town report.
They're in the town report, right. Yeah. But we don't even give town reports out anymore. It's on the web, right?
Right.
So, how many people look at that? I don't know, maybe everybody, but maybe not very many people. And if we had it posted when you come in, like when you come in the school, you see who is on the school building committee. You see who the architect was, yada, yada, yada. And I think if we had something nice looking, we could put it up on the wall and maybe have a copy of it somewhere else as well, in the old town hall, in the town hall, I should say. Jonathan would remind me, in the town hall. So, what do you think, Fred?
I don't know, but this, you know, they're in the town report, like Mary Ellen says, and I guess if you put them, made a listing somewhere on a wall, well, you'd have to keep changing them, I guess, because they change every year, whatever.
Potentially.
Maybe it's people that aren't on committees that volunteer to do stuff for the town, and I guess I'm thinking of the volunteers that have helped Mark with this building. I mean, some of them are not on committees. And I guess I was thinking, before this item came up, that maybe we should maintain a list of the people, so when we're all done with this building, whatever that is, that we have some kind of maybe ceremony or whatever, a recognition event.
Sure.
When all these 18 people have donated time to help us with this building. And you either, you know, do it in a report or put a plaque on a wall, I guess, if you want. But as far as the, I guess, the regular committees and all, I think that's already recognized in the report. Now, maybe some of them we could put on the new website, because some of them don't have all the people on the committees. You know, a good one is you know, Highway Department, I think it only has Keith on there. He's got, what, 3 or 4 people or whatever under him. Same with Fire Department. You don't see them people until they're in the annual report. He's got 18 or 20 or whatever people on the Fire Department that, you know, maybe the place is to put them on the website as recognition for them people that help. Well, we could still, you know, that's one suggestion. I'm not opposed to putting them on a wall somewhere if you know, somebody wants to maintain that list.
Well, I think it doesn't have to be a complicated thing. You could have, like it's in the town report, right? In the printed town report, you have a few pages of this. You print out those pages, put them up. And those pages are printed out because they're on a computer file somewhere. And if there's a change, you go and erase somebody else, put somebody in, print that out, tack it up there. Okay. I mean, I'm not talking about a plaque.
Okay, well, we can do that, on a bulletin board, whatever, if you want.
Yeah, that's easy enough.
Yeah,
I think we update every year.
Yeah, I just think, you know, people come in here, they'd like to see. Yeah,
but I still think the other two items I brought mentioned.
Oh, I think those are good ideas, too. I think an employee of the month or a committee member of the month or even somebody like Fred Singh, somebody who helps out and isn't on a committee or isn't an employee. You know, takes a village and, people deserve recognition. And what was the other thing? Mary Ellen, you mentioned something. You mentioned the employee of the month.
Or volunteer of the month.
Volunteer of the month. And there was another suggestion. Fred, do you?
Well, for the building.
Yeah, for the building thing. Oh, building, sure. That could be a more.
Volunteers.
Maybe that's a more elaborate. Well, you have the whole municipal building committee.
Right. But I'm thinking, you know, people that helped with this sign or plaque. We had some help with the flags, I guess. Maybe the flagpole and whatever is going to go outside there later on.
Maybe other things. You helped a lot of help.
Somebody volunteered for the. The partition there in that room, the plastic wall partition,
yeah,
I guess, that
was a
volunteer.
Cleaned.
The shelf outside the window, right, that somebody volunteered.
Yeah, and people help move stuff over here, and I think we ought to have a housewarming.
Yeah.
At some point. A party.
Right, once we're all done.
Once we're all done.
And not to give you guys more work to have a party, maybe we could get some volunteers to have the party for everybody who did the work.
Right.
That would be good.
Right.
I think that'd be great. So wait until the weather's better.
Some form of open house would be a great idea.
Right. Yeah. Okay. No rush on that one, but it should go on our priority list.
Okay.
Right?
Yes.
So in the meantime, we'll continue to brainstorm that and try to come up with a list of open seats as well, because there are several open seats, and hopefully we'll. Other people will reach out and want to find some of those.
Good.
Yeah. Treasure collector program. I didn't skip anything else, did I?
No.
Okay. So I'm going to ask you to, and I guess what I'll do is I'll have you, Paul, have you sign in Jonathan's place, but. This is a contract to upgrade the treasure collector software. Right now we're using a DOS-based operating system. We'd like to upgrade it to a Windows-based system. It can be funded through the treasure collector budget, and this would interface much better with the water meter reading program and whatnot. So we needed your signature to do that.
So good.
What's the estimate for that?
$2,100, $2,104.
So is everybody going to be on Windows?
Is everybody? This is the treasure collector
right.
software. It's a DOS-based program
now. Okay.
And this would, it's the same software, it's Point.
Point, yeah.
But this would upgrade us from the old version to the new version, which would interface with the water billing and all that, and it's way overdue.
I'd say DOS?
Yeah.
Well, it's still DOS underneath probably, but nonetheless. Okay, so town administrator updates.
All right, I'll make these quick. Historical Society insurance, I just wanted to follow up on this. At the last meeting, you guys asked me to reach out to Maya, our insurance carrier, and ask them what they would suggest we require. And I'll just pass out an email response with suggested certificates of general liability coverage. I did forward this along to the Historical Society, and they intend to get a policy and will give us a certificate as soon as they have it, listing us as additional insured. They would not be covered under our current insurance.
No.
So
they should get insurance.
Yep. And they haven't been covered under our insurance for...
Oops.
So do they have insurance right now?
No.
Okay, so
well, they may now, because I did give this to them last week, and they said they were on it. So they've already had several conversations with the insurance company, so... I think they just needed to know what we were requiring, and then they could sign the policy. So they may have done that.
So they're paying for this?
Yep.
Insurance.
Okay.
Good.
That's one of the conditions of their rental, is that they provide insurance.
Were you also going to look at liability insurance for other town properties, or that's not an issue?
Liability insurance for other town properties. We have liability insurance. You mean for other people using?
Right.
I don't remember that coming
well,
up.
The one, I don't know, I thought it came up was, say the snowmobile club using and taking parts on State Road.
It would be the same as this. This would be just a permanent policy. They would have to provide a policy for, you know, whatever their events are. I don't know how, do they meet regularly?
So does the snowmobile club have a liability policy?
No, nobody.
Yeah, there's no policy with regards to the use of town hall. I mean, there's nothing formal.
Maybe we should have something.
No, but I guess my concern is with that property on State Road. I mean, if, I guess we're assuming the town is allowing them to use that property for snowmobile use, whatever you want to call it, the parking of vehicles or moving them in and out. But what's the liability if somebody gets injured on that property while they're doing that? Does our insurance cover that since we own the property, or do they have to have their own insurance?
Are you talking about DeMille?
Yeah, DeMille property.
I didn't even know that was used. This is the first I've heard.
I didn't either.
Well, haven't they come to the town before to seek approval to use?
I don't know how much they've been using it.
To use that property?
Right.
As meeting places or whatever?
That's news to me. I didn't know that. I can ask that question.
Well, I think this begs the question of having a town policy about insurance, event insurance on town property, and that the policy ought to be something to the effect that organizations using town property or facilities should have insurance, event insurance.
Yeah, they're not covered by our insurance policy. I think mine was pretty clear about
that. So what about when somebody uses Whately Field? You know, they have, well, the fire department has a rally down there or something.
Yeah, but the schools use it.
The fire department's a town organization, so would they be covered?
The fire department would be, but I don't know about outside organizations.
Yeah, I don't know how many outside organizations.
The Grange is another big user of town.
The Grange would be another one.
You also got, you know, the snowmobile club not only going through DeMille, but they go through by the highway garage and around the fire station, town property. So it's not only, you know, the DeMille property, it's others. Plus, they're down here by Whately Park, there's the trails.
So if somebody gets hurt in a snowmobile accident on town property, we're liable?
I don't know.
Trails should be covered under Sam's insurance policy.
Who's Sam?
Snowmobile Association of Massachusetts.
Should be.
Okay.
Not for parking, but on trails, marked trails.
On trails, yeah. But I was told at one time there's a certain distance off the trail, they're still covered.
I don't know that.
I think so.
Well, we should look into these. I mean, on the other hand, you know, I don't want to make a range pay for it. I don't know
what the cost of these policies.
Well, I guess I would ask the snowmobile club what they have for liability insurance. And then, I guess you could ask the Grange too if they have anything.
Yeah, and I can follow up again.
But our insurance would say that anybody, any organization who uses one of our facilities, town of facilities, is, we are liable for anything that might happen to them.
No,
if they don't have insurance.
What they're saying here is that the Historical Society is not covered under our insurance, and that's why they need a policy.
Okay, so that would, anybody,
right.
Nobody is covered.
Right, that's my understanding at this
point. So we've been lucky for these past 300 years or whatever it's been, right. 200 years.
So I'll work on a policy and do a little more research and come back to you. But in the meantime, the Historical Society will get this policy. Like I said, they may have already done that.
Well, I think it's fair. I mean, I don't want to burden anybody with additional insurance costs. But, you know, if the Historical Society has to pay, well, then maybe everybody should have to pay.
My understanding from talking to Jane and Adelia is that this policy will also provide them with some form of contents.
Those, I mean, they have theft or damage.
I don't know what
stuff.
Yeah, fire or theft. I'm not sure what it is, but they, right now they don't have any insurance.
Oh, okay, so that might be a little different.
This has another additional benefit to them.
Okay, so it's not just personal liability. If somebody trips and falls.
Yeah. And I don't know the details of the policy that's between them and their insurance carrier, but that's my understanding. Yeah.
Well, you might want to check also with other towns and see if, you know, their snowmobile or their Grange or whatever.
There's lots of policies out there.
I'm sure there are.
It would be an easy one.
Yes,
even the insurance company may tell you that.
Insurance companies love to insure people for whatever.
Right.
Okay. I've got town policies. I mean, it would be easy to get policy.
Oh, town policy, yeah.
Sorry. All right. Insurance policies.
I just don't want us as a town creating burdens for organizations if there's no potential for liability.
Okay, I'll do a little more research on that. The next item is on my updates here, budget season. I just wanted to let you know that the budget season is obviously underway. The Finance Committee began its review of the FY17 budget last week. They were presented with an early draft on Tuesday, and they're going to be meeting on this coming Wednesday with Highway, Police, and Fire, the second. Tuesday, March 15th will be Library, Water Department, and Rec Commission. Tuesday, March 22nd will be School Budgets and a Budget Hearing. And then Tuesday, April 5th, they will meet to review and make recommendations on the annual town meeting warrant. So that's their schedule, and I just want to let you know that things are moving ahead on that front. Real quickly, the water merger has been kind of a conversation that's come up quite a bit. The water commissioners have invited in the water district to have a conversation with them at their meeting. It's the first Tuesday of the month. Is that right?
Yes.
So they'll be meeting next week. Just to kind of get everyone at the table to make sure that everyone's on the same page before we invest too much time and energy into merger discussions and appointing a committee. So I just wanted to let you know that this coming Friday, on this note here, this coming Friday, there's a deadline for a Mass DEP planning grant for water infrastructure. Well, it's called the Water Infrastructure and Planning Grant. They're going to be awarding 25 grants throughout the state for a maximum of $40,000, and there's a match required of somewhere between 10 and 25% based on the town.
Sure.
Anyway, I know this is a little premature because we don't know whether we're going to be moving forward or not, but I would like to apply for that grant. Mm-hmm. If we get accepted, or if they decide to give us the grant, then we aren't going to move forward with merger. We don't need to accept that there's no requirement.
Yeah, okay.
But I'd like to throw our name in the hat, even though it's a little early, just because I feel like,
sure,
you know, it's an opportunity to fund some of this engineering, planning, mapping, things like that.
Okay.
So if you're okay with that, I'll do that. And we'll have an answer very soon. The turnaround on this grant is mid-March, I think.
Wow.
It's happening real fast. So.
And that's probably for using this year's fiscal money.
I believe it needs to be used within this fiscal year by June 30th. So assuming they decide to move forward, we could use this money to do things like do some planning work for the merger, do some mapping of the two systems. Right. I'm not sure exactly what they would decide to use it for, but at least our name's in there and we have a shot at it.
Correct. Yes.
Finally, cell tower update real quick. Tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. is the required cell tower site visit. If the weather's bad, I may offer another time slot later on in the day, because it is mandatory under the RFP, and I know the weather's supposed to be terrible. If any of you want to come, you're welcome to come.
Would you add any interest in it yet?
You mean in the way of questions?
Right, or anybody asking or inquiring?
No, we've been getting calls all along asking when the RFP was going to be released. We had someone call today, one of the cell tower companies, but unfortunately, according to the RFP, if you have a question, it has to be in writing so that it can be shared with any potential bidder. So my only response was, if you had a question, you have to email me the question, and I haven't heard anything. So that's all I have for updates, but just wanted to let you know that it's moving forward, and you know, if the weather's terrible tomorrow morning, since potential bidders could be coming a long distance, I'll just give them another time that works for them, if you're okay with that. Yeah. I don't want to discourage anyone from.
What other time were you looking at? This week still, or?
Probably not this week, either later in the day tomorrow or sometime early next week.
Fine.
I'd like to give them as many opportunities as possible to come look at our cell tower. The next item is a request for approval on a bike race on April 23rd. This is the route, and I'll just real quickly explain it while you guys are looking at that. This is a cycling team from MIT. They're interested in hosting a cycling race through Whately on, I believe, April 23rd is a Saturday. They spoke with the chief of police, and he believes there's no issues with the course from a safety and traffic standpoint. They'll be using roads in Whately starting at 10 a.m. ending no later than 5 p.m. There's approximately 300 racers in the total. They'll post volunteer marshals at every turn, and they say with half of the 300 racers on the course at any given time. They'll continue to work with the Whately Police Department to determine where officers will need to be placed.
So it's just going, Whately's one of the towns it's going through?
Whately is not starting or ending point. They're just going through Whately. Okay. I believe it starts in Greenfield and ends.
It's 27 miles, so. Yeah, it probably comes down the river and
maybe
goes
it loops back
maybe
to
in the Hatfield, and then who knows. I can't tell from this map, but yeah, that's fine with me.
Okay. They needed official approval from you, and of course,
just people know we like bicycles in Whately.
Is this an annual thing? I've seen them go by before.
I think they did come through last year.
Last year,
at least last year. I don't know about other years.
Well, there's various bike races throughout the year.
Yeah, but I think this one in particular, it's been at least, they didn't do it last year. I don't know how many years prior, but she mentioned that it was approved last year, and they just wanted to get it.
I don't remember it, but it's fine. Fine with you, Frank.
Yeah.
All right. So, lastly, MLS extension.
Yeah, and I do have two very quick unanticipated business items for you. No. The MLS, unfortunately, I haven't heard back. Can I just have that map just to keep it with this Jim's approval? The MLS was supposed to. Unfortunately, they have not signed a lease yet for their new space in Northampton. I asked Greg Pronovitz, the director, to give me a formal request to timeframe for how much longer they would like to be in the space. Didn't hear back from them before this meeting, so I'm going to just request on their behalf a 30-day extension, allowing them to stay in the space where they're at. But I would like you to consider the condition that if it goes beyond the end of the month, that they relocate that office into another section of the building, so that we have that space available for meetings. We're going to have a meeting problem in April. I think we can get by in March, but I'd like to have that set up as a meeting room by April. So.
Fine with me.
So when they leave, they would take all the furniture with them. And will you get the ones you're buying? How soon will you get that furniture?
Well, the funding, assuming it's approved, okay, would be on March 14th, and then there's a 4 to 6 week lead time.
Right.
We can patch it together with, you know, we don't need to have this many chairs.
No, but I mean, if they're taking everything and we're standing up for 2 weeks.
No, we'll make sure that there are chairs here. You know, I have like 25 chairs from the school. We can use those in the meantime.
Okay, so there's a...
We'll have plenty of chairs to get us by, but the chairs, once we get them, would put it back to the way it looks now.
But even if they move to a new location in the building, I mean, this furniture stays until they actually move to Northampton.
Yeah, this would stay until they really vacate the building. So.
Okay.
And you had two other things?
So these are two items that hit my desk today, so I apologize. But I guess Lynn is having a hard time getting election workers for the primary. The people that generally do it, unfortunately, are out of town, or some of them. So she's asking that you appoint Fred Barron, Sue Barron, Donna Whiley, and Tony
Bershensky.
I so move.
Okay, second.
Good.
And then lastly, just some signatures for, there's quite a few of them here. These are for reimbursements for Chapter 90. They're all projects that have already been approved and completed, so.
The election workers, that was just a one-time deal for the primary, or is that a permanent?
I think they're annually, right?
Adding permanent workers?
Once you're appointed, you're appointed, I thought.
Oh. Yeah, you don't have to be appointed.
Okay, so it's a continuing thing. It's not just for the primary.
We have more forms.
That's all I have.
Warrant being signed, I move to adjourn.
Second.
Good night.
Thank you.